Black Oni.
This is Solid Snake, and you are now listening to the Black Oni podcast. So pay some damn attention. Damn.
Welcome, everyone, to the Black Oni podcast. I, as you can all imagine, am so excited to bring this episode to you today. This is episode 91. We are climbing our way over to 100, which is, you know, a lot of podcasts don't even make it out of 10. So I'm really proud of that. Really proud of that. Before I go into detail about anything else, I want to take a moment to introduce our guests as well as our hot seat special guest. So first and foremost, right next to me, we have Dream Manifested. Please tell the folks at home.
What's going on, everybody? You know who it is, the man, the myth, and the legend, the Harem King himself. You know, I had to jump on for this podcast today because it's a very special thing. And I like to be around the special things. But yeah, you know where to find me, Dream Manifested, IG, Twitter, and most of the other things.
Beautiful. It's Yoru Chris. What's up?
What's going on, everyone? ¿Cómo le va? Toda mi gente. Thank you for coming. Always a pleasure to be on the podcast. Looking forward to today. And hell yeah.
Yes. And last but not least, obviously, the special guest of today, David Hayter.
Hello. Thank you for having me. And I'm sorry to all of your listeners that I kept you waiting, huh?
Before we go into our icebreaker, I just want to say most of the people who are in the chat right now who know me already know that I'm a gigantic Metal Gear fan. It's actually the biggest reason why I became an artist growing up. I was inspired by the overall package of what was being presented for Metal Gear Solid. It was breaking the wall of what I expected a game could be. Everything down from the music to the convoluted storytelling, to the voices especially, all of that really resonated with me in a way that other mediums hadn't before. So I just want to take a moment to, first of all, like, let you know that, and also address that, like, this is a really dope moment for me.
I appreciate that. I'm so happy to be here, and I'm so happy that Metal Gear was an inspiration to your career and your art. I hear that from a lot of people, and that's really the greatest achievement that a piece of entertainment can boast. So thank you so much for saying that and having me.
Yeah, man, my pleasure. As we do in all of our podcasts, we start with our icebreaker.
Icebreaker.
I think you might need that one next. That one.
Yeah. Right. Right. Just take a sound clip of it.
Now you got it.
Yeah.
I think I was like, that's the one going.
That's
forward.
The one.
Icebreaker. Yeah.
What is the scariest game you've ever played?
Silent Hill. Sorry, what was your follow-up?
No. I was going to say if you didn't have one for someone else to go first, but why Silent Hill?
It scared the bejesus out of me. I played a lot of horror games, and some of them are scary, but that was genuinely like living a horror movie. It freaked me out, and that bell, the gong would start going, and the world changed, and you know, the opening where you're just... I'm talking about the first game because I never played any of the others.
Smart man.
Where you're moving through the alleyway and it's just, and then you realize you're being chased by little skinned children with knives or whatever. Oh my God, it was terrifying. It was so beautifully executed, so to speak. And yeah, genuinely scared me.
Mm-hmm. What about you, Chris?
Oof. Obviously, RE was pretty terrifying as a kid with playing with Pops, but Dad did get Silent Hill as well, and I remember that scene very vividly, just being like, man, this is a weird game. This isn't like Resident Evil. And then you go down the stairs, and like the world just starts opening up, and you're like, all right, this is terrifying. And yeah, and then you're in like Silent Hill's like core, like terrifying world, and you're like, all right, this is, I need to get out of the room. My dad, yeah. David, my dad used to play a lot of like horror games when I was a kid. So I have a huge love for horror games, and also every single time doesn't fail to get me like, all right, I'm terrified, but I need to keep playing.
Yeah, I played all the Resident Evil games. I love them. And, you know, sometimes they're scary, things pop out at you, but it was nothing like Silent Hill. Silent Hill was so disturbing and suspenseful. Yeah. And, you know, it was like, it was just, you know, the cinematic effects of it were really upsetting.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, ahead of the time, Team Silent, I believe at the time, was working over there at Konami for this, but they were like, all right, try not to be RE-like, but also try to, like, you know, bring the best qualities of, you know, like, Resident Evil at the moment, and then all of a sudden this game just comes out, and it's just like, yeah, this is terrifying.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, y'all are better than me. I'm not really the biggest horror guy. I played the PT demo. The Resident Evils, I did play them back in the day. As compared to some of the actual more horror games, I don't really feel like they were that scary. You know, you have your little, oh shit, and you shoot something. As long as I can shoot, I'm fine.
Right.
Most recently, the thing, like, I started playing, Biohazard? That's a little creepy just because it's more a little bit like Deliverance in my way.
Wait, isn't Biohazard just Resident Evil?
It is.
Yeah, Biohazard is.
Okay.
The thing that has actually gotten me the most recent is actually Call of Duty. Because it caught me off guard. It's those stupid boxes, man. Like, I would turn my head, and I was like, yeah, talk to my teammate, yeah, about to open up this box, and then it's just on your screen yelling. It's like, oh, it was soul. It hit me in my soul. So I'm not, like I said, I don't really find a lot of things too scary, but I don't, like, Outlast is a no-go for me. If I can't fight back, it's not happening.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. That's
Fatal
my choice.
Frame for me would be a close second.
Yeah,
Fatal Frame is right up there too, though. Oh, Crimson Butterfly. No,
Outlast for me was just like, because you couldn't fight back, you could literally only hide, and what was chasing you was human enough, but also like it was just delving into non-human very quickly and in interesting but creepy ways.
I haven't played that one, but
yeah,
you walk around with a camera.
That's
it.
I don't know.
I don't care for that. If I don't have an axe or a shotgun, I'm not interested.
Yeah. Yeah, I don't blame you. And kind of going off of that as well, I don't know what is going on with the camera over here. I'm going to have to refresh this, but we'll continue talking in general anyway. What, David, was the first game that you've ever played?
Well, you know, I'm old as hell. The first game I ever played was Pong, man.
Yeah. So
I do my birth predates video games. So I've been there since the beginning.
Yeah.
And actually, I did, when I was living in Japan, I was 16, a video game company came to our school and found four English speakers, including me, to do voices for arcade games. And I don't know what games they ended up on.
What?
But I've been doing voices for games since they've had voices in games. So
I've never known that. And I feel like I've done my research.
Yeah,
I've looked into things.
I've said it here and there, but it's...
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, you know, I mentioned it here and there, but it's a little annoying because I can't remember. They never told us what games they were going to be in, but you know, we did pilot voices and soldier voices, things like that, and we just did a few hours sessions, and it was pretty cool. So, as an old school gamer, I was really jazzed to start my career there.
Okay, very cool. Looking back then and looking at now, maybe this has changed, but what is your favorite gaming genre?
RPG.
Okay.
You know, I love a good story, and I love sort of the leveling up of that of those worlds. You know, like I really loved Horizon Zero Dawn. Oh, I loved Ghost of Tsushima.
Yes.
You know, there's something really satisfying about sort of building up from a character that sucks into a badass who can conquer anything, and I just really enjoy, you know, I enjoy those as I do, like, you know, epic movies, that sort of thing.
Yeah.
I mean, I like all kinds of games. I like flying games. I like Star Wars games, of like, you know, all sorts of things. But I really like the what was the last Star Wars RPG? Fallen Order.
Yeah.
Is it Fallen Order?
Yeah. Fallen Order. Yep. Yeah. It is Fallen Order.
Yeah. So I like that one a lot too. And, yeah. I also like playing Spider-Man. I think I'm gaming too much.
There's no such thing.
Is that a thing?
I feel more people honestly should be, especially in Hollywood, should be playing more games. For a multitude of reasons. It kind of just expands your conventional thinking of things in general. It kind of challenges you in ways where you have to be active and passive listener and participant in the story.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. It also lets you know what kids are being presented with, you know, what worlds they're experiencing, and what, you know, it keeps you from sort of repeating things. It allows you to take elements from great games and apply them to films or television. So, I agree. I mean, these are the worlds that our audiences are living. And so I think it really helps as a creator to know what the state of the art is.
Mm-hmm.
I agree. And it's something that I've actually tried to convey to my parents between games and anime.
Right.
My dad used to play games with me back on the Sega, like every now and then. But he fell off. But it's like, they always like, how can you be into it? And it's like, it's just another medium. They literally, it's just another way for you to get a story across. So if you just take the time, you might find an animator that you like. You might find a game and say, okay, this story is interesting. Now I got to learn how to press these buttons, but I'm here for the story.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Then, you
know, let's try to get
the buttons tend to hang up the parents, but.
Yeah.
So who are you telling?
Well, it's like Metal Gear.
Yeah,
it's like Metal Gear. You know, my parents would have loved to have known what I was doing, but it's so complex and so difficult to work that, you know, there's just no way. You have to be a real gamer to get through those games.
Yeah. Yeah.
Oh man, I just had the realization of just you just trying to explain to your parents what you're doing and the convoluted storylines. I'm just like, oh my god.
Oh, I don't.
So
even,
I'm doing this. Right.
It was the Super Baby Project, and you get lost pretty damn fast.
Yeah. And speaking, you mentioned earlier about your very first voice acting job when you were still a student. What was your early career like? Like, what happened after that? What was that transition like?
Well, then I kind of got hooked. I mean, I was already into acting. You know, I would do the school plays. I produced plays, you know, for me to be in, and this was all I ever wanted to do. And then after I did the first voiceover job, I was like, that seems like the best job in the world. So I started doing like English language tapes in Japan. I started doing commercials. I was, it's embarrassing to say, but I was a model. So I'd do, you know, they'd hire me to play a gaijin waiter in a tuxedo or whatever. And, you know, I just snagged whatever jobs I could get in Kobe and Osaka. And then I came back, when I left Japan, I went to theater school in Toronto. I studied theater and all sorts of things, singing, dance, everything. And then a year later, I said, to hell with this, I'm moving to Hollywood. And so I did. And that's, you know, I just started hustling in Hollywood. And after a few years, I started working. And then about 8 years in, I had my two big breaks, Metal Gear and X-Men. And I was on my way.
Yeah. So when you... I'm gonna go with the question that I already have on here, because I have a lot of other questions that can spawn off of that. But
sure.
What made you, aside from your original work with voice acting, what made you decide that you really wanted to go down that route? Like, whether it was just like it was what you had been used to doing at that point, or a desire?
Sorry, you mean voiceover specifically?
Yes.
When I was a kid, my parents would do like funny accents and things, and you know, they talk in an Irish accent, or they, you know, do this or that or whatever. And so we'd kind of joke around with voices since I was little. And my mother was an actress, and when And then when I went to theater school, I should be speaking like this. I trained my voice to, you know, project to the back of the theater, and I gained a lot of control, breath control, learned to sing, you know, all that stuff. So I just had a facility for voices, and when I started getting voiceover work, you know, it was just like doing a radio play, and I realized I could, like, you know, give a sense of action to my voice, a sense of movement. You know, it just seemed to fit. And like I say, it's, you know, it's arguably the greatest job in the world. It's pretty fun and not too much pressure, and the people are all universally nice, you know. I mean, they're nice enough on camera, but there's a lot of egos and stuff, and in voiceover that just disappears.
Mm. So,
you know, it's a nice world to be a part of. So actually what happened was, I did an episode of Major Dad, which I think you can find on Hulu, where I played the son of a Russian soldier coming to visit the major. And so, you know, I had a Russian accent. I speak like this. I make out with Major's daughter, you know. And a legendary voiceover director, Gordon Hunt, who's Helen Hunt's father, hired me, was in the audience when we taped it, and he hired me to play a Russian on Captain Planet.
Oh.
And so I went in,
no way.
And I, you know, I went up to the casting director, who was Chris Zimmerman, who eventually ended up directing all the Metal Gear games. And I said, look, I've never done this, you know, before. I'm a little nervous. And she's like, just take your script, sit over there. We'll all go into the booth together and you'll be fine. So I said, thanks. And I took the script and I backed out and I bumped into a guy and I turned around and it was Mark Hamill. And I was like, this is pretty cool.
Yeah.
And literally standing behind him was John Rhys-Davies, who played Sala in Raiders of the Lost Ark. And I was like, what is happening? And everybody was so cool, so sweet. And so, yeah, that's where I really got hooked. That's where I was like, this is the best job in the world.
Wow.
That's amazing. I actually do have a question as it pertains to voice acting compared to actual acting. You act
I would say on camera acting.
Yeah, on camera acting. There we go. You got your start with doing the voice acting first or the on camera?
My first gig was, I was 15 years old and I booked a Hostess Taquitos chip commercial in Toronto. And sort of the lead of the commercial was this 17-year-old actress named Cree Summer. And I don't know if you know who Cree Summer is, but she is a legendary voice actress.
Yeah.
And I was so in awe of her. And I just got to hang out for 2 days and shoot that. So technically my first pro gig was on camera.
So, and the reason why I asked is I was just curious, and between the two, do you find it harder or easier to get into character when you just, or in the voice acting world, when you're reading a script, do you get the opportunity to do some of these scenes or acts like with your teammates around, or is it always by yourself?
I think it's easier to get into character in voiceover because you have the benefit of them not seeing your face.
Okay.
So it's just your voice, and you're going to have an animated character pasted over your voice.
Right.
So the animated character does a lot of the work for you.
Okay.
Not that you don't have to do work. You have to, you know, figure out your character. You have to do this thing. But if my character is Solid Snake, that's one thing. If he's a big tar monster, that's another thing. And the visuals of it give the audience mental cues as to the believability of the character. When you're on camera, there's no place to hide. Like you, especially if people have seen you in other things, if you're trying to do something different, if you're doing an accent or whatever, that's why it's weird when a super famous actor does, you know, a new accent. You're like, well, that's not how he talks. Like, you
know. Right.
So, but you throw on an accent in voiceover. I played a, you know, somewhat Scottish guy in The Long Dark, and he was this huge guy with a red beard, and it's like, don't let me die, Mackenzie, you know. And it helps you a lot. So, and then there was another part of your question that I can't remember.
Long
ago.
I think it was kind of just, do you actually do your lines and stuff with your cast, supporting cast? Or like in terms of, like you mentioned, the animations kind of, do you see the animation? Does the animations happen before the voices?
Depends. It's always different. So I did 9 Metal Gear games, and I always wanted to see the actors or the animation to record with it. Like the first game we did, Metal Gear 1, was done. So we did the animation 2, or we did the...
Cut out a little bit.
Oh, can you hear me?
Yeah, we can hear you now.
Okay. So in Metal Gear 2, the game wasn't finished. So we just had... We had voice tracks that we could see. So we could see the length of time we had to speak, but we couldn't see the characters moving. Yes. And then in Metal Gear 4, we had video of the motion capture actors, but not the finished game. So it was all Japanese actors in the ping pong ball suits climbing, you know, 2x4s and stuff like that. And you had to act to that. So,
okay.
So it's always different, but most of the time you don't get the script in advance. Like most of the time, you just get it, and when you hear me read the line, it's the first time I'm reading the line, which makes it difficult.
Gotcha.
To make it sound natural.
Duly noted.
Hmm.
Yeah.
And, you know, you just mentioned Metal Gear. It's a perfect transition. Most of the community here know that, obviously, I'm a big Metal Gear fan. That's the instantly recognizable thing. I remember hearing in an interview before kind of what it felt like to kind of start doing that. But what was the, you just mentioned just now what the process of seeing those lines for the first time, for example, being like, but how would you compare that to some of your other experiences in voice acting?
Well, a lot of times it was a lot weirder.
Yeah. You
know, I was like, what the hell am I talking about over here? And you know, all that complex backstory and everything starts coming at you. And I haven't had a chance to read the script. So I'm like, what is the super baby method? Like, what am I talking about here?
Genome soldiers.
Yeah. Sonny's making eggs. Like, what the hell? Yeah. You know, there's so many weird tangents and histories and all this stuff. And so I just have to, if I don't get it, I have to ask Chris, the director, what does this mean? And she tends to, you know, she'll call Tokyo and say, get,
she don't know either.
Yeah, no, I mean, we don't know. And so we have to find out from Kojima's team, like, what am I talking about? And how do I know this person? And is there a history here? Like when Gray Fox shows up, you know, there's a huge amount of history between those two characters.
Yes.
But for me, it's, I'm in the place of the audience. I don't know this guy. I don't know what, like, how do I feel about him? How do I, were we friends? Were we enemies? Well, kind of both, you know, it's,
yeah.
It's a strange situation in something as complex and occasionally bizarre as Metal Gear.
Yeah. And I feel like that could be a strength if it were any other IP where it wasn't quite as convoluted, where like you're getting into it for the first time and you're like, oh, you get to be caught off guard. You get to react naturally to what's happening. But that only works if you have the context.
Yeah. Well, that's the point. Is yeah. You need context. And I think, you know, but that's part of what makes Metal Gear so compelling is you feel that there's a huge world here that you're seeing glimpses of and that it just goes on and on and on. Mm-hmm. And that makes for a pretty epic experience. But yeah, you know, translating it on the fly is not easy.
Yeah.
I can imagine. I have a question, actually.
Yeah, shoot.
Do you read, are the scripts given to you on just any voice acting or like a gig? Are they given to you and you have to read them, you know, like from start to finish? Or are they just like, hey, we're going to jump into this action scene, or hey, we're going to come, you know, like we're going to have you read this monologue and then jump you around in bits and pieces throughout like the throughout the game or the script?
You know, in on camera, you get the script in advance and you get to work it and work it and work it. In voiceover, especially with games with NDAs and stuff,
right,
that doesn't tend to happen. Like the only script I got in advance on Metal Gear was the first one. And I started reading it, but it was literally a stack of pages 2 feet high. Like, I mean, it was, you know, it was so, it would have been like reading War and Peace or something. Like there was no way to get through it.
No way.
In the week between I got cast and playing the part. But no, and then that took, so just to give you some idea, Metal Gear 1 took us 10 days to record. Metal Gear 4 took us 9 months.
Wow.
So the script for that would have, you know, filled the room. You know, there's no way to even FedEx it.
Yeah.
I don't tend to get it in advance. I just did the pilot for an Australian anime show, which is a secret. I can't tell you what it is, but this is the first I'm talking about it here.
Let's go.
It's an exclusive.
Okay.
Hey, we got it.
And that one, and again, because it's anime, it was weird. And so they sent me the script in advance, and I, you know, that was 22 pages, so I was able to go through it and figure out what I was doing in advance. Cool. But it's always, you never know in advance what it's going to be. Every job is different.
Mm-hmm.
That's awesome. And also kind of like, yeah, just how quick are you and to think on your feet and how you can, you know, deliver this while going, oh my God, just all in order.
Yeah. Yeah, it's a unique.
That's awesome.
It's a unique set of skills.
Hmm.
A certain set of skills.
How much did you practice the specific voice for Snake before settling on it? And what would other versions of that sound like?
Well, I auditioned with my real voice, which is this.
Yeah.
And, you know, like I say, I'm older now. At the time, I was 28, and I sounded pretty young. And so I got the script, and I read the opening scene. With the colonel and being, you know, in the submarine being launched out to the thing. And it was like, he'd already retired. He was already a legend. He didn't want to be brought back. He was bitter about it. And I felt like this guy's older than me and I've got to put some road miles on my voice because I really sounded like a kid. And so just reading it, I was like, I gotta add in this weight and this bitterness and scars, you know, make it sound like he's just got scars and experience. And so it kind of just came out of reading the scene. You know, it didn't make any sense to me to say, you know, Colonel, I didn't want to come back because it sounded like I'd never been anywhere. So it just became that, what it became. And then, halfway through recording the first day, Chris said, hey, can I play you the voice you auditioned with? And so she played it for me. It was completely different. And I was like, oh, is that bad? Like, you know, do we need to redo it? And she's like, no, I love it. So that's how it happened.
Wow.
Yeah,
that's so good.
That's how it happened.
Yeah, yeah, you answered both of those questions like perfectly. It was like, what would it have sounded like otherwise? And you're like, just me.
Yeah, it would have sounded like me. I mean, I used to play... all I ever played was heroes or fighter pilots or, you know, just sort of heroic young characters. And that's what I got cast for, but it became something else because of the situation.
Yeah. That's so dope. What would you do if you could write Snake differently? Because
that was dope. Yeah.
Yeah. Right. Some of the people, at home may not realize that you also write, you direct, you, executive produce. How would you write Snake differently?
Oh, well, that's a dangerous question. My writing voice is not the same as Mr. Kojima's writing voice.
Yes.
I write, you know, so I wrote, I was the, you know, X-Men, I was a writer on X-Men 2. Those films, X-Men 2 in particular, is really represents my voice, like what I do, which is sort of, you know, poppy, hopefully smart, heroic American films. And it's difficult for me. I mean, I try to write in different styles and sometimes I pull it off, but I couldn't write Metal Gear. I barely understand Metal Gear. You know, there's so much brilliance and unique writing and a unique voice and so much research into the state of the world and genome manipulation and armies for hire, like all this stuff that I just couldn't do it the way Mr. Kojima does. And that's not to say that I'm not proud of my own writing. I am. I love particularly, you know, X-Men, X2, or I was very, very proud of remain very, very proud of those films. But I think if I wrote Metal Gear, it would be a lot more American style action movie. Like I should be writing the Metal Gear movie, but for some reason I'm not. So
who do we have to talk to?
I've already talked. I mean, Jordan. I talked to Jordan about the director of the movie, and
right.
Anyway, well, he can talk about that.
Okay,
but we're pretty close. He's a good man and a big fan.
That's good to know.
Yeah, that is good to know.
Oh yeah, he's awesome. Yeah, we got together, you know, pre-pandemic, obviously, at a Hollywood speakeasy and just drank for 4 hours, and it was great. Really bonded.
Awesome.
Good man.
That sounds like a good,
he's a good
time.
Man, and he really knows Metal Gear, and he really cares about it from a fan's perspective. So hopefully that movie will get made and be great. And there you go.
That's excellent.
Well, that makes us happy too, because it's always a thing of like, here's Hollywood trying to adapt something that we are very passionate about, and at the same time you're like, please don't mess this up, please don't mess this up, please don't mess this up. And they've casted a very good director, and they have a lot of great supporting cast too. So it's something that a lot of us are looking forward to, and it's really nice to hear that you're behind Jordan's vision too. So it's like,
oh, totally, yeah. Actually, I pitched him. I had put together a pitch for the Metal Gear movie long ago, and you know, we pitched it to Sony, but they weren't ready to move forward on the movie yet. And I talked to Jordan. I was like, well, here's what I want to do with the movie, and he stopped me halfway through, and he's like, stop. That's what we're doing.
Like, that's great. Okay.
that was pretty cool.
That's really comforting to hear.
Yeah.
Oof. I'm feeling better about the movie.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh yeah. No, it's definitely in the hands of a super fan, and you know, it's hard to translate. It's a very strange and complicated world. So, but I felt so much better once I got to know Jordan.
Mm-hmm. What has been the most useful advice that you've gotten as you started your journey?
I don't know. Never, you know, you get knocked down, get back up. Just keep breathing. Don't take it too personally. You know, if there's a problem, just write it out. Think your way through it.
Mm-hmm.
Don't take the punishments and the humiliations too personally. It's all a long journey, and you've got to, you know, I kind of play it like a game. Not that I don't take it seriously, but that I don't let it kill me if, you know, a movie doesn't do well, or some critic hates me, or you know, I write something and they're like, no, we don't like this, and they cancel the project. You know. The first movie I made that I produced was called Burn. And when the sales deal, we had a deal set up with a studio and it fell apart. And that was sort of the lowest point, mostly because I was broke and I didn't have any money.
Been there.
So of course. And it, you know, it happens to everybody, but I was so devastated. And I was like, I can't work any harder than that. And if that's not going to, you know, pay off, maybe I need to quit. And then literally the 2 years later, I ended up writing X-Men. And so, you know, since then I've had many, many disappointments, failures, what have you, but I've also had a lot more money. And so it made me feel better.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah,
it's easier to take the failure if you got a nice house and a pool and whatnot.
That's true.
I can imagine.
Yeah.
So that was the best advice that you had received?
That's a compilation of the best advice that I ever got. And I'm regurgitating it to young people who are striving to make their voices heard, to be successful, to achieve success. So yeah, it's just a mishmash of my philosophy, I guess.
Yeah.
Gotcha.
Yeah. Yeah. I totally, I totally align with that. You know, there's, especially when it comes to bigger projects like that, that you've done all of the legwork to get to where it is, and for whatever reason, it just didn't end up panning out the way it should have. You know, I totally know where you're coming from when it comes to that.
Yeah. I mean, I think everybody does. It's, you know, you look at people who start their careers and are just instant superstars, and then they remain so for their entire life, like the Rolling Stones. You know, they were 17 years old, mm-hmm. 16 when they started. By 17, they were playing arenas.
Yeah.
You know, but that's just not. It's possible. You know, you can be Leonardo DiCaprio, go out to Hollywood, get a TV show, turn into a giant movie star for your entire life.
Yeah.
But that is
rare.
A, it's very, very rare. And B, you have to be born with that, you know? But the point is that anybody, if they have the fire and are willing to work, can make themselves an artist in whatever they are driven to do, if they're driven hard enough, mm-hmm. if they are unwilling to be stopped,
mm-hmm.
You know, anyone can go out and achieve these things. But it's likely to be a bumpy road. It's likely to be a long road, and you know, you have your ups and downs, and that's the reality for most people.
Mm-hmm.
So, and I would even say, you know, I'm sure Leo has his ups and downs as well. It's mm-hmm. just they're a lot more comfortable than ours.
Yeah. What would you say has been the biggest difference in between how you've approached your work with voice acting to writing to executive production? Because those are all fairly different things. There's a lot more that I don't fully know about executive production, because I know that can be broken down to many different definitions.
Well, there's all kinds of different producers. There's creative producers, there's physical producers, there's money producers.
Yes.
I'm sorry, what was the framing of that question? Like, what is the difference between those things, or how did I find my way?
I would say, it was kind of a weird way to ask it, because I actually changed it a little bit. How's your approach been different for those three different things?
So I started as an actor, and I was writing mostly for myself to understand acting better. And I'd written some short scripts and a feature, but I never really had any idea how to sell my writing.
Mm.
You know, I just didn't understand that world. Acting, I was like, well, you just put your face out there and you're, you know, super good looking and everything will be fine, right? So that seems pretty straightforward. But the writing I didn't know how to do, but that was something I loved. Then when I produced Burn in 1998, I raised $250,000, and I physically, you know, produced that film with my line producer, who knew how to do it. But I, you know, I was there every step of the way, sort of putting together the film, casting it, getting the sets built and all that stuff. And I found out, you know, and that's more management, you know, that's like running a company.
Mm-hmm.
And I found out that I was pretty good at it, and that it was, you know, it was behind the scenes, but it was really fun and challenging to pull off.
Mm-hmm.
My dad was a big biotech executive. And so I sort of took his attitude and his, you know, work ethic and applied it to that. And I found out that I really loved producing, and there's just a whole different set of skills that I discovered in myself. And then, you know, a year after that, I ended up working on X-Men as a professional writer. And then I had to develop those skills because, you know, in some ways I was a good writer, in some ways I was a terrible writer. And I had to have like A-level people sort of say, yeah, this is good. This is not good. Don't do this anymore. So, you know, it's a learning process for all of those jobs, and I love them all. It's nice to be able to sort of jump from one thing to the other.
Yeah. A lot of people don't really get the opportunity or even the drive to do so many different things within the entire production role. So
yeah,
that alone is super cool.
I was very fortunate, and I knew, you know, my friend group included very talented people who were doing amazing things and opened doors for me that you know, allowed me to have this weird and varied career.
Mm-hmm.
That's a beautiful thing.
Yeah,
it is. It's, and again, like I say, you know, you go out there as an artist and you just sort of embrace the things you love and you bring love and positivity to it and energy and hard work, and people recognize that and they're like, oh, you know, what people don't understand is older producers, older money people, they want young people to come and make the money.
Yeah.
You know, they want to, you know, they look at you gentlemen and say, oh my God, look at your energy and look at your talent. And I want to, you know, they want to exploit that. They want to make money, but in that way, it allows you as the artist to open the doors to larger audiences. And a lot of that comes from attitude, attitude over talent. So, you know, in many cases, I mean, talent is very helpful.
Mm-hmm.
But being willing to do hard work and being, you know, on fire with it is really the key, I think.
Yeah. Now
I'm just soaking in all these jewels. That's all.
No, I appreciate that.
It's a lot of valuable information and also context as to even some of the other questions that we're going to ask you too, which is, you know, you mentioned kind of that trajectory in learning process of going through all these different things. How did Warrior Nun happen? How'd you start working on that?
Well, you know, it's interesting. I and this is a good lesson too. When I was younger, so I'm friends with Jennifer Hale. You know Jennifer Hale?
Oh, absolutely. She's phenomenal.
Legendary voice actress, and she's just amazing.
Yeah.
She was already one of the top 10 voice actresses in the world when we were both in our mid-20s. And she said a cool thing. She was like, you know what? I'm going to go back to a place of being a beginner and really look at my career as starting fresh. And instead of being like, oh, I'm already a pro, nobody can tell me anything, I'm going to be open to every new thing. And it was just such a beautiful attitude.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, cut to, I don't know, many years later, a few years ago, I was like, you know, feature movie writing is really frustrating, especially if you're writing expensive movies, because most of the time they don't get made. Nobody wants to pull the trigger on $100-150 million movie. So I was writing all these movies and I was making money, but nothing was getting made. Mm. And it was really dragging on my heart, and I was just getting tired of it. And I was like, you know, there's only so long they're going to keep paying me to not make movies. I mean, you know, they're still doing it today, so who knows? but TV in that time became so good, where I never wanted to write TV before. Suddenly it was like, you can do so much more on a TV show than you can in an expensive movie. Expensive movie, they don't want you to take any risks. Do anything. You can go super far and explore riskier things. So I said, you know, I want to be a TV producer. So, you know, I was a big name writer, but people were like, you've never done TV before. So they didn't trust me, give me the keys. So I said, I'm going to do the Jennifer Hale route. And I met with Netflix and I said, look, all I want is TV experience. You don't have to give me some huge deal. I mean, you have to give me a pretty good deal, but you don't have to give me some. You don't have to give me a crazy expensive deal. I just want to work in a writer's room and I want the experience of putting together a season and figuring out what that's about. And so this executive, Chris Regina, told Simon Barry, who was the showrunner of Warrior Nun, look, David Hayter's looking to get TV experience. Would you be willing to bring him on board? So Simon got in touch with me. And said, yeah, come on board. So I came aboard as I was a supervising producer, like a sort of a consulting producer. And we put together this show and it was awesome. And I just got to run with it and work in a writer's room with other people, which as a screenwriter, you don't get, you know, you're just in your room going insane.
Right.
Right.
You know, and I was like, I might be too crazy to work with other people at this point. You know, I might be I'm too used to having my own way. I'm too bossy, you know, whatever. But it wasn't like that. It was just, everybody was super nice and collaborative. And we came up with the first season of that show, which I'm so proud of. Like, I think it's really unique in its voice. I think it kicks ass. I think it really is very empowering for young women. Yes. It was a completely racially diverse room. So we were, you know, it was, our goal was to be like, celebrate everybody and give everybody their power, which was everything I ever wanted to do. So yeah. We made the first season. It came out great. And when we got picked up for second season, I got promoted to executive producer, and now I'm, you know, second in command on the show. And so I put my ego aside. I started again in a new arena, and you know, it's working out pretty well. So now I'm producing an animated show at Crunchyroll, which we'll be announcing soon, I believe.
Is this the Australian thingy?
The Australian thingy I just got offered as an actor.
Ah, okay, gotcha.
Which is really cool.
Yeah.
So it's kind of cool. I get to go back and be an actor. I don't have to worry about the scripts. I don't have to worry about, you know, production or anything like that.
Yeah.
So
that must be nice.
Oh, it's great. Oh, it's great. When I get to just act in something, you know, yeah. I don't have to worry about anything. And I'm like,
you go back to doing the thing that got you into this in the first place.
Exactly. It's just simple and it's beautiful and you know, and it's super fun. And I mean, you know, producing a TV show is super fun, but it's a lot more stress and it's a lot more work. And so.
Yeah. I'm actually showing the trailer for Warrior Nun right now for anyone who was unfortunate enough to not have seen it already.
Oh, cool. Yeah. That trailer is pretty badass.
It's great. Yeah. And I literally was like thinking to myself watching this, I was like, this reminds me so much of like a comic book, but it's so different. It's so interesting. And I'm watching it with my fiance, and her mom has watched it and loved it and has been, you know, telling us to go watch it. And so we finally watched it. We saw the trailers on Netflix. I was like, this is so cool. It's like, the name is super weird because it's like, okay, I guess she is a warrior nun. So, you know, maybe Swords of the, I forgot what the thing was. I was like, that would have been such a cooler title.
Oh, the Order of the Cruciform Sword.
Order of the Crucible. Ooh. That was like, that'd be so cool. But then I remember seeing the credits and I saw your name and I was like, there's no way. Like, this whole time, someone else I've already like known and respected doing all this other stuff is now like executive producer on this project. That's so cool.
Thank you so much. Sorry, I'm asking my wife to bring me a drink.
Yes, please. Please.
Drink or a drink?
No, just a drink. the drinking doesn't start till 6:30.
Gotcha.
But then it starts.
Yes.
Then, just don't stop.
Then we're not messing about. Thank you. Like for example, if you watch episode 4, Warrior Nun, that's I mean, I had a hand in sort of developing all the episodes, but that was the first one I wrote on my own. Mm. And so that's the one where Sister Beatrice faces off in the hallway and all those dudes. And I was like, this is my chance to show them what I do and to define the action of this show. And so I did. So I just went balls out on that sequence.
Yeah.
And then our stunt people were like Game of Thrones people from Spain. We shot it in Spain. And they just, you know, the sequence just blew me away. So, so that's, you know, that's, that was an example of, you know, and like, if I was working on a feature, it would take me 7 years to get the film produced, to see the sequence done or whatever. This, we just wrote it. 6 months later, they shot it. And six months later, it was on TV. And it was really cool. Really cool. So I'm very excited about season 2 and we got some cool stuff in store.
As am I. I'm very excited. Understandably, I'm doing a lot of streaming and a lot of my art stuff as well. So I don't get to watch as many shows that are out there. And so, you know, this is definitely one of those things I'm really looking forward to.
Oh, thanks, man. I really appreciate that.
Yeah.
It's a labor of love. I love our cast. I love our crew. Love our writers.
what was your biggest challenge with all of this, with especially with COVID? I don't know. You said six months. So I imagine COVID probably was just starting when some of this stuff was happening.
We were, thank you, sweetie. Appreciate that. we were in the middle of breaking season two when COVID hit. And actually we were just ready to go to scripts. So it actually, the timing worked out kind of well because we were finished with the writer's room. We were all going off to our own spaces to write the scripts. So we did. And then ever since then, every meeting's been Zoom and all of that, but it's not bad. I mean, it's, you know, I'm very, very fortunate in that voiceover and screenwriting are two jobs you can do from home.
Anywhere.
So,
yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So, you know, I can do them from Vancouver. I can do them from Europe. I can do them from wherever. And so
yeah,
just very, very lucky.
That's great.
That is awesome. Real quick question. I got to ask, what's your favorite drink or your favorite drink?
Favorite drink?
Yeah.
I drink beer, Japanese beer, mostly Sapporo, Asahi, and then I drink Irish, Canadian, and Japanese whiskey.
Mm. Mm.
And that's pretty much it. I don't.
Jameson.
Yeah. Jameson's not my favorite. There's a lot of really good Irish whiskeys. That I go for. Jameson, you know, Jameson's sort of the standard, but I try to branch out into weirder ones. And
yeah,
well, I will have to do the same then, because Jameson, like Jameson preferred. Got me out of what is it, Jack Daniels. Like, once you have Jameson, like Jack Daniels, you can't do it. It's like,
oh,
yeah.
Yeah. yeah. The Jack Daniels, I like bourbons as well, but Jack Daniels is a little mass produced. It's gives you a headache.
Yeah.
So try Tullamore Dew or Teeling whiskey is really good. When I was playing Ghosts of Tsushima, I would drink Toki Suntory whiskey,
which
seemed appropriate.
That's pinky excellent. Out while you're playing too, right?
What's that?
Pinky's out while you're playing, right?
That's right. Well, I stuck with the pinky out because it just seemed weird.
Some big class.
So just in the realm of kind of getting a chance to relax as an actor, voice actor, producer, all these amazing hats. So you play Ghost of Tsushima, you play games. What is it like as far as watching stuff? Like, do you sit down and just watch stuff?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, you know, if you do as much writing as I do, which is every day, and it really drains your brain, you have to refill the well. And so, yeah, I watch great shows, movies, you know, things that inspire me. Well, I was rewatching Aliens last night, just taking in the brilliance of that direction, and every aspect of it is incredible.
Mm-hmm.
What else? I just watched Borat 2, which I thought was pretty amazing, and I think he's so gutsy and cool for what he does. Also, that I don't know if you've seen Borat 2, but
I haven't seen the 2.
The girl who plays his daughter, it's one of the greatest comedic performances I've ever seen. Like, she just goes toe to toe with Baron Cohen and is amazing. So I would highly recommend that. I don't know. I watch all kinds of things, and I play guitar to sort of relax my brain, and I play video games to relax my brain, and to learn, you know, to experience stories that I don't create.
And that kind of spawns two other questions for me. One, I'll ask the second because it's really not as important. But the first one is, as a creator, when you're watching things, and as you said, refilling the well. As a writer, because I write poetry and music, and a lot of times, like, I consume that a lot, but you don't want their voice to trickle off into yours. Do you find you have something that kind of, you have to actively go against that?
Well, I think Stephen King is what inspired me to be a writer in the first place. His writing my entire life has been massive inspiration. And so when I first started writing short horror stories just like him, not as well as him, But I think that writers tend to start out by imitating what they love, you know, and that's okay. You will, as you develop as a writer, you'll find your own voice and you'll find out what you're good at, what you're not good at, what you need to learn. And so I don't think there's anything wrong with, if you're hugely inspired by some awesome song or poet or whatever, I don't think there's anything wrong with figuring out what really fires you about that voice and finding that element within your own thing. You know, when I was in theater school, there's a great actor named Colm Feore, who you've seen in a million things, a Canadian actor, but he's just in, he plays the dad in the Umbrella Academy.
Oh, okay.
Okay.
We're just watching that now.
Yeah, which is really good. So he came to my acting class and he said a cool thing, which was, look, if you love Harrison Ford, go do Harrison Ford. Because when you do, it won't be Harrison Ford. It'll be your own interpretation of that. Or, you know, whatever actor you love, take those elements and just, you know, process them through your own brain, through your own voice, whatever. There's nothing wrong with that. But of course, you know, on the other side, you want to stand out and you want to be unique. And so you got to embrace that too. So I think it's a balance of processing the things that fire you, you know, ignite your soul and the things that you're good at and just diving into it.
Certainly. And then the last question was, have you watched Cobra Kai?
Let's go.
Because I don't know. I have so many feelings.
I was told so many times to watch Cobra Kai, and I was not only was I a massive fan of the first two Karate Kid movies, but I lived that. I was the Karate Kid. I was a skinny kid. I learned to fight. I learned karate specifically, and then fought back against bullies. That was my life story, and and I was the same age as the Karate Kid. So everybody was saying, "Well, you got to watch Cobra Kai." And I'm like, "Yeah. I'll get to it." But it was on YouTube Red, which I didn't have, and so I never got around. Then it came on Netflix, and it changed my life. Like, I was just so blown away by that show, and it seems so simple, and it seems so, you know, sort of, you know, light and airy, but at the same time, to pull off that tone, that perfect tone, which is joyful and tense and cool, and it's not dour like so many things are. And it also, from a writing perspective, you understand why each man thinks the other guy is the bad guy. Right. Like, you are completely
right.
You're like, if you were Johnny, you'd know why Daniel was a dick. And if you were Daniel, you'd know why Johnny was a dick. Mm-hmm. And that's so hard to pull off, you know, and all of them. I mean, Hawk and...
Oh, my God. Hawk,
yeah.
He needs a whooping is what he needs.
Yeah, he does.
Hawk needs to go back to beginning, bro.
Hawk needs to go back to being a beginner. And the girl, is it Alicia? You know, I love her story. I love every single one of them. I just love these people.
Oh, that's...
Dope.
I just love it. So I tweeted about it, and the creator of the show is I don't want to get it wrong. John Hurwitz, I think. He tweeted me back, and he's like, "Oh, thanks so much, David. I really appreciate it." I'm like, "Oh my God, I love this show." And I almost was like, "I want to write on that show." I was almost like, "I want to write on that show," but then I was like, "No, I just want to watch it. I just want to." Experience it. If I go on, I'll ruin it.
Okay, I haven't watched it yet, but like you, everyone has been telling me to go watch it. I'm like, okay, I guess I'll get it.
I fought against it, and then, like, I really burned through both of them seasons probably in 2 or 3 days.
Wow, that's great. Yeah,
you know, it's like. So I love The Boys, for example, or The Umbrella Academy, but they're so bleak, and so dark, and they're funny, but in a really horrifying.
Yeah.
Ugly way, which is cool because it pushes the boundaries and it's edgy and I love those shows. But there's just something so great about watching Cobra Kai and you just know you're going to be grinning through the whole thing and just it just so captures the energy of that first film. I'm just blown away by it.
Yeah.
So that's my rant about Cobra Kai.
That's amazing.
Man, I love, my friend actually turned me on to Cobra Kai, because I'm a huge like nerd from like the 80s. Like, I feel like my dad showed me Karate Kid
nerd from the 80s.
same.
For real.
Anyway, I'm sorry. Then,
No, you're good. And the anecdotal part of all this is just like, he grew up in Chile watching Cobra Kai, Karate Kid in the sense. And he was always like, that's so cool. And then he actually watched Cobra Kai before me. And he was just like, you need to watch the show. And then my friend Mark was just like, I don't know. We should watch like Great British Breakout. We watched a couple of episodes and then we went right into Cobra Kai. 2 to 3 days, we were done with both seasons, hands down. It was like my brain turned off, like for regular, just like normal, you know, brain activity. But then for like the, you know, how it was written, how it was shot, some of the continuous continuous scenes and continuous angles are just unreal in that show. And it just makes you appreciate just the stunt work. I love stunt, you know, like just like stunt
and the old school karate
and just sorry,
go ahead. But it was like so I studied karate. I mean, I studied a few other forms, but it was mostly karate. And you know, it's not MMA, it's not jujitsu, it's not like kung fu or whatever. It's just old school karate, and I freaking love that.
Mm.
Sorry, I didn't mean to cut you off.
No. My audio is sometimes like trying to catch up in time, so no worries. I'm sorry if I sound like I'm talking over you, but I'm not. It's just trying to catch up.
Not at all.
Yeah,
and I just think the final thing about that, I just think the world is so crappy and so stressful right now that it's such a breath of fresh air to have something that's just fun and not cynical. And so anyway, it just really made me happy. And I think that's why your brain, you know, explodes when you watch it.
Yeah.
It's a good show overall and highly recommended even from Mr. David Hayter himself, but go watch it.
Yes. You had a very, you're really good at these transitions here. Talking about bleakness and finding happiness in the world right now in 2020. These are obviously the questions that may be difficult for some, but I feel like are important to bring up because, you know, November 3rd is approaching very soon. I gotta ask, context for myself, I've had to distance myself from people that I've known from the past who support Trump. Like just straight up who just like, yeah. I'm all Trump. I'm all about everything that's going on. I've been friends with them before as they were Republicans. I have no problem with people being Republicans. I just have a major issues with Trump. Oh God, where do we begin?
Why is that? He seems so nice. I'm just kidding.
I know you're kidding. How has navigating the political landscape been for you as someone in this line of work? How has that played out for you?
Well, I work in entertainment. We don't have a lot of Trump supporters in Hollywood. I mean, if we do, they keep it to themselves because they want to keep working. You know, look, I agree with you. I never had a problem with my friends who were Republicans, but this is not Republicanism. This is not conservatism. It's just hate and bile and stupidity.
Yeah.
So yeah, I hear you, man. If somebody is still down with this after kids in cages and, you know, fine people on both sides, I got very little time for you. And, but it hasn't really affected my work. I mean, it inspires me to try to present a better message to the world, but I was doing that anyway. I mean, I always believed in heroic stories, and I always believed in that everybody deserves love and respect and, you know, to embrace their own power. So, you know, I think Trump in a way drives the desire for more of that, which is good for my business. I'd rather be gone than have my business boosted, but but we are where we are. So you know, at the same time, look, the real problem is Fox News. You know, they created a bubble wherein your friends who are not stupid don't get any real news. You know, they're just in this, they're in this horrible bubble where they just get fed lies. There's a moment in Borat 2 where Mike Pence goes up in front of a thing, in front of a group of conservatives at CPAC, and he says, yeah, so the United States has about 215 COVID cases right now, and we've had one death, and everybody just buys it. And it's like, you know, so I try not to hate Trump supporters. I mean, if you get my face, I'll deal with it. But but I try not to hate them because they're not, they're just not getting real information.
Mm-hmm.
You know, but at the same time, you should be smart enough in this world to find out what the real facts are. You should, if you're supporting this horror for the sake of tax cuts, you're a fool.
Mm-hmm.
And because you're not getting those tax cuts anyways. and so that's my feeling about it.
Have you had to, distance yourself from anyone, in general, not even just family, but.
Yeah. We had some friends, that, you know, had a daughter, was my daughter's age, you know, super nice people and lots of fun, but they were, you know, hardcore conservatives. And then when Trump came around, I'm like, can't do it, man.
Mm-hmm.
I can't, you know, you either you pull your head out of your ass or we can't hang out mm-hmm. anymore, mm-hmm. you know? So there's been some of that. And we got one of them in my family, which is just horrifying, but I never really spoke to her before anyway.
Okay.
It hasn't really been bad. It's only bad on the internet, really.
Yeah.
You know, people, if I say something positive about Biden or whatever, you get a bunch of crap. But even there, I mean, the people that follow me are pretty woke in general, and they don't ask me about it unless they want to get blocked.
Yeah. Facts.
He's just like, I'm ready. I'm ready.
Yeah, you know what else? Like, typically, if somebody calls me out about it and says, no, Trump's awesome or whatever, if they follow me, I'll send them a direct message and say, hey, man, like, you're buying into a bunch of ugly crap that's really dangerous for the world and for other people. And sometimes they're like, you know, fuck you and you suck and blah, 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 and Biden's this and that. But sometimes, you know, they love me so much that they're willing to talk it out. And I really... those are the people we need to convince, you know, mm. we don't need to convince us,
mm-hmm.
but there are younger people who just their family's conservative or whatever. They don't hear anything but this horrible conservative news slant.
Mm-hmm.
And some of them, you know, wake up, and that's really the people we need to get. So I really enjoy, and I don't, you know, unless they get nasty with me, I'm always very respectful with them and just say, look, man, you know, you might want to look at this issue, or, you know, I try to wake them up, basically.
Yeah.
And sometimes it works. Most times it doesn't, but that's fine.
Yeah.
If it doesn't work, that's when you put them to sleep. I mean,
well, CQC, you know?
I knew it was kind of, I was like waiting.
I don't, unless they attack.
Yeah.
It's just straight up just
something stupid.
Go to sleep, go to sleep.
Oh my god. Yeah, one thing that I oh my god. Not to get us off topic or anything like that. I've just when you said just like consuming like good media and stuff like that. There's also another series that me and my good friend Mark have been watching like crazy. It's called High and Low. It's
High and Low? Oh, I don't know it.
Yep. It's Japanese media. It is based off of the TV series that they've had beforehand, but they have all the movies on Netflix, and it's very the storyline is very coherent. You can understand it. You can just kind of brain off, enjoy the fight scenes, enjoy the very well done stunt choreography. A lot of the story elements are really, really well done too. And it just goes to show you how how like one little movie or TV series can just explode into this universe. And I think that they do crossovers with like other like Japanese fight manga. I believe The Worst is also part of it. So highly recommend to anyone on the podcast, but I would love to hear what you think on it.
where do you find it?
Netflix.
Oh, Netflix. Okay, cool. I'll look it up. That's awesome.
Awesome.
Very dope. I don't have any other questions aside from what you've already answered. In terms of chat, they asked what your favorite anime was.
Well, I like a lot of the ones that I'm in.
Yeah.
Lupin, Castle Cagliostro, and I was the lead in a series called Fushigi Yugi, The Mysterious Play.
Mm. Fushigi Yugi.
Yeah, yeah, I was Tamahome.
No way.
Miyaka! I was Tamahome. And but beyond that, actually my daughter has just gotten into My Hero Academia, and so we've been watching that with her, and we're in season 4, and that's awesome.
Mm-hmm.
And very, very cool. I don't know. Those are the ones I know. The ones I'm in, and I know Academia. I don't watch a huge amount of anime, but
mm-hmm.
but I do love the art form. I mostly love the movies, the Miyazaki movies.
Okay, mm-hmm.
You know, we just rewatched Spirited Away, and I've seen them all except for I haven't got through Porco Rosso yet or The Wind Rises, mm-hmm. but I've seen the others.
That's dope. So,
Parker Russell was actually much better than I thought I was going to be.
Yeah, I don't know. Yeah, I just haven't committed myself to sit through it yet.
Yeah. Those. So I'll say here that, you know, we went over the time just a little bit. If you need to dip out now, again, totally doable, totally workable. If you're hanging out and enjoying the show, we can talk about some of the other stuff we have on the channel. And I'm sure chat also has more questions.
Why don't we do another? My computer's dying. I have to see. Let me see if I can find another plug for this because it's not working.
Okay.
But yeah, I'll stick around for a bit. Chat amongst yourselves. I'll be right back.
Okay. Sounds good.
Awesome.
So is the future project with the Lord and Savior Kojima?
That's why I was like. I was just like, I'm not saying it, but I mean.
Yeah. No. I will ask those questions. Chat, if y'all have more questions for him that we didn't already ask him, or you'd like some elaboration on, please let me know, and we'll be happy to ask those questions. Initially, when we started discussing and getting this together, I only told him, you know, 45 minutes at most is what it'll be. I'd like to pat myself on the back here and say that every one of our guests that we've ever had on here, I told them it would only be however long they had. And it's always been longer, so I feel good about that.
Well, always happy to have a good chat.
Yeah.
Yeah, it really is. So I have to ask.
Yeah.
Your daughter's into My Hero Academia right now. Who's her favorite character? Who do you see yourself as?
Oh.
And who does she see herself as, or her favorite hero, or her favorite quirk?
Oh,
it's hard.
Let me see.
Yeah, I'm sorry.
No. She goes on and on about her favorite characters. She loves Kurashima.
Yeah.
she loves Bakugo, and we argue about it constantly because I'm like, he has no redeeming features. Like he's just a jerk all the time, and you know, he's obviously going to end up being a supervillain or something like that. And she's like, how dare you? You know, you can't insult Kachan.
Oh my god!
Just teen angst and daddy issues. That's all it is.
Yeah, I guess so. So yeah, exactly. So hang on. The interviewers want to know who your favorite character on Academia is, comma, and your favorite quirk. Period. We'll see if she answers.
Yeah.
So, my God, this light is so much better. I wish I'd done this from the beginning. I opened the window. and for me, she's like, wait, what? I'm gonna get a text like 4 hours long.
Yeah, I was like, you open the floodgates now, man.
Yeah. I love so many of them. I love All Might, which in English is voiced by my friend Chris Sabat, and I think his performance is so good.
So good.
In our house, it's dubs, not subs.
Yeah.
Because that's we are a voiceover household. I know. I like both versions, but yeah.
That makes sense.
Who else do I like? I love Todoroki.
Mm-hmm.
I love Froppy.
God, Froppy is so cool. She's so cool.
Oh, sweet. Okay, so Natasha says Kirishima and Yayurozu are her favorites, and Momo Yayurozu has her favorite quirk.
Mm.
Okay, so that's awesome. So she'd like to create all types of like just like gear for each situation. So very forward thinking. That's pretty dope.
I guess so. It's like why? And I'm like, because.
I definitely got the same vibes about Bakugo becoming a villain later. Like there was a time I think in season two where they had he and Isuzu had their fight, and mm-hmm. like I feel like after mm-hmm. that, maybe less so, but still, it's like this part of me who's like, he's just going to turn into the villain, and I'm cringing at the thought of it. But
I'm not gonna speak that on him. Nope.
like I say, my daughter gets outraged when I suggest that, but it's he could also, go through some arc where he learns not to be such a jerk, but he's just like Endeavor, where it's like all he can think about is competition and how powerful he is or whatever. And I'm like, I enjoy watching him as a character, but he's such a jerk.
He's a dick. He's totally a dick.
Dude, at the beginning he is, and then I don't want to say any more, but if you read the manga, know that he actually does have
she's reading the manga. Like she's up to the minute. So
okay.
So, I know that there are things that are paining her about my interpretation of Bakugo, but
that's what we got.
I only got the information I got.
Yeah. That's right.
I'm glad as a dad, though, you're kind of identifying these, like, no, this guy's nuts. I've had this discussion with my girlfriend, too. She's just like, how can anyone like this character? He's literally on the brink of just, like, snapping and killing things. And I'm like, yeah, you're all
right. There's a difference between a character you enjoy and a character you can admire. And I think, I enjoy Bakugo. He's hilarious. But still kind of a dick.
Yeah. Someone asked a question that I think I already know the answer to, but maybe maybe not. Someone asked if you are going to be or currently working on another project with Kojima.
No, not that I'm aware of.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
No, I'm not being coy. I don't know.
Yeah. Yeah, that makes sense. I feel like we would have heard at least a hint of something. A little
maybe.
Twinkle in the
eye. We're pretty good at keeping these things secret, but I have not been contacted to do so.
Oh, I did have a question. Because Gaiva is my thing. Have you watched the Gaiva anime?
Yeah, I watched it for research.
Okay.
For the movie, yeah, of course.
See, I didn't realize it came first until my, my adulthood. I was like, oh, I get it now. But yeah.
No, I got the part. I'm like, what is this? This is the weirdest thing. And then they said, well, it's an anime. And so I said, well, can you send me the anime? Because I didn't have any money. And so yeah, they sent it to me for free because that's the perks of my job.
And Gaiva 1 or 2?
Sorry.
Gaiva 1 or 2, like.
Which do you like most?
Which one do you prefer?
Yeah. The one I'm in.
Well, duh.
Look, I love Steve Wang and I love Screaming Mad George, who co-directed the first one. Steve directed the second one on his own. The first one is a lot of fun and got amazing creature work or whatever, but it's so silly and sort of goofy and doesn't take it seriously. And I feel like, and that's kind of been how I had a career, which is taking comic books seriously.
Okay.
And you know, manga, anime, like they take that those worlds very seriously. And so I feel like the tonal shift to Guyver 2 made it a better movie for me. But don't tell Mark Hamill I said that.
No, I felt the same way because I know what the second one was actually was. It was actually rated R, wasn't it?
Oh yeah, it was brutal. It was brutal.
I busted
up that rhino zoonoid. I cracked his hands backwards. I blew his eyes out. I finished him off by putting my hand against his head and crushing his skull against a tree. I mean, it's awesome.
Good time.
I've never seen Guyver.
Gnarly.
I've never seen it. Now I've never
seen Guyver. Oh, yeah. You gotta watch all of them and the anime. Do it.
No. Okay. Okay, because Guyver was like the mech suit that had like the blades on the arms, right?
Yeah. So I'm the star of the live action sequel movie.
Yeah, I remember seeing the visuals of that, but I didn't see the actual movie itself. So,
well, not only the creature effects are amazing because Steve Wang sculpted the original Predator, and so he sculpted all of these creatures, which is incredible.
Yeah.
But the fighting in it, you know, predates The Matrix, and it's full on kung fu. Like our stunt guys were astounding.
Wow.
So, you know, there's like spinning wheel kicks in the air. I mean, it's the fighting is amazing. In fact, we used examples from Guyver 2 for the fight sequences in X-Men.
That makes sense.
I was sitting in my office working on the script and the stunt coordinator, Gary Jensen, walks past and he's carrying Guyver 2 in his hand, a VHS copy. And I'm like, Gary, where are you going? And he's like, I'm going to show, the director with this movie. Have you ever seen it? And I was like, Gary, turn it over. And Gary turns it over, and he looks and he goes, "That's you." And I said, "Yeah." He goes, "Why is that you?" And it just goes,
broke his mind.
It blew his mind.
That's so great.
Yeah, it was cool.
I love that.
More questions from chat. Can you ask if he has met a character he wished he could have voiced? Okay, great question.
Yeah, I always wished I could voice Batman, just because I love Batman.
And yes,
he's an inspiring character for me. But
yes,
like Kevin Conroy, you know, so he's iconic, and I love him. So, although I auditioned to play Batman in the Telltale Games, game, but I didn't get it. So that was one. I don't know. I mean, I guess that would be the one. I mean, there's things that I see where I'm like, oh, that's a cool character. I would have been fun to do, but I try not to get too hung up on things I didn't do.
Yeah, and also I love Batman. You mentioned RPGs earlier. Like action RPGs are like my main genre. It's like
I love that
progression. Yeah,
it's Rocksteady, right? The Rocksteady games, the Arkham games, are
phenomenal.
So, although I love just see the SNL sketch where Bruce Wayne's talking to people and all the white folks are like, "Oh, Batman, you know, he's really cleaning up the streets," and then all the black folks are like, "Oh, somebody's got to do something about that guy."
I saw that. So funny.
They're like, oh, Batman. Oh, yeah. Somebody's got to do something about that guy. But, you know, he jumped out of the sky, landed on my cousin, broke his leg.
Yeah. It's like, yeah, man, he beat my cousin up for walking down the street jaywalking. I was something like that.
So I'm a little conflicted about Batman.
Oh, my God.
But those games are really good.
Yeah. Another question in chat was, is there another character that you voiced that you really wish there was more content to do voiceover for?
All of them. I mean, like I say, this is the best job in the world. I wish we could do 10 more Metal Gear games.
Me too.
I don't think there's a game that I've done. The only character I couldn't do more of was King Shark on The Flash.
Yes.
His voice was like, "Where's the Flash?" And it's so rough on my voice, I can't do it for more than 25 minutes without losing my voice. So
yeah.
But apart from that, I mean, like I've been doing Star Wars: The Old Republic. So I play the lead Jedi, male Jedi character, the player character.
Oh, no way.
Yeah. And so that one we've been doing, and I the way I got the job was the actor who was playing him fell out when they started making the games, and Jennifer Hale suggested me. And so they said, well, what if, she said, what about David Hayter? And they're like, would he do it? And I'm like, yeah, play a Jedi.
Yeah. Right.
So I started doing it, and we've been recording those games for 12 years now. Or that one particular game. And it's so fun. Wow. To just every few months I go in and we go to a new world and I kill a bunch of other people, and it's pretty great.
That's so cool. Another question in chat. Has any anime made you read a manga of it to get more info on a character?
It's disappointing, but no, I don't think so.
Me neither. It's fine.
It's fine. Yeah, no, I watch the shows and that's it, but I don't read a lot of manga. I was given the manga for Promised Neverland. Because we were talking about doing it as a show, but that didn't come together. But I did. I was reading those manga. That was pretty cool.
That is certainly a dark show.
Oh, is it? Really?
Well, that's why it didn't come together. I was like, I don't know how to do this live action. Like, this is so upsetting, and you'd have to. It's kids and a bunch of kid actors, and I just logistically, I didn't think it was for me.
That'd be gnarly, though.
What's that?
That would be gnarly, though. Oh my lord! Just a live action. It's like,
well, it may still happen. I don't know. Hopefully,
but you're a part of that.
Something to potentially look forward to. What's a TV show or movie that you'd like to reboot or put your own interpretation on?
Well, I can't really answer things like that, because it's like people say, what comic books do you want to adapt? What video games do you want to adapt? As soon as I say it, somebody else grabs it.
It's happening.
Yeah. Or people interpret it as I am doing that. It just gets complicated. So it, again, not a terribly satisfying answer, but I can't really say.
That's totally fine. That's
understandable. Fair enough.
That's just the realities of the internet age.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Someone asks, what sort of principles or practices would you recommend for someone trying to construct voices? You mentioned earlier a little bit about kind of your traditional training in theater and learning about that.
Yeah. Learn, I would say take singing lessons to learn to control your breath and your voice. I would take voiceover lessons, study with some great pros and casting directors. Listen to amazing voice actors and figure out how they do what they do. So a lot of great voice actors like Nolan North, Hank Azaria, people like that, they'll do bad impressions of people. Like Mo, the bartender, is an impression of Al Pacino from Dog Day Afternoon, but done in a way that's kind of different. Homer. That sort of thing. So figure out how to do that. Figure out, can you do an impression? Can you do Michael Caine and then turn it into something else? That sort of thing.
That's kind of blown away, not gonna lie.
Yeah,
I recently did the video game Bloodstained.
Yes.
You did Bloodstained, right?
Yes.
Right.
Yeah. Oh, so God. I play Zangetsu in that, but I also do the opening narration. They were like, "Will you do a different voice for this?" So I did little Ian McKellen. I did my best Ian McKellen, and then the days of Bloodstained were this and that, and Frodo, blah blah blah. Not really Ian McKellen, but it's kind of a cool, sound voice. So
take on it.
Yeah,
that's a great kind of callback to when you say, if you want to do Harrison Ford, do Harrison Ford, but it'll be your own version of it.
That's right. In fact, I just did a video game where I was like, kid, what the hell? I did my Harrison Ford, but when you see it in a different face, it won't. It'll just be a weird voice,
Yeah.
That's so awesome.
What games are you most looking forward to? This is kind of. You actually did touch upon a lot of the things that are in the other parts of the podcast as well, which is wonderful. which games are you looking forward to most?
I can't remember what's coming out. I like Cyberpunk. Looks pretty amazing. We just had a bunch of cool games. I was really looking forward to Ghost of Tsushima.
Yes.
Ghost of Tsushima, which I loved. It's so beautiful.
If you need people to play multiplayer, listen, I'm your guy. I
appreciate that, but I don't play multiplayer. I play games to get away from people. So.
I feel that.
That's so real.
I don't. No
Call of Duty. Okay, gotcha.
No Call of Duty.
That's why we laughed at your Call of Duty.
There's nothing wrong with it. And no offense to anybody. I just like to shut my brain off, and not deal with. The only online game that I play is Star Wars Battlefront, because I love the Star Wars flying games, ship games, and so, but playing with like 12-year-old people, it's like being eaten by ants. You know? They're just all over you, and so I'm like, I have no desire to.
I've never heard that analogy before.
I love that. I love that so much. That's just a bunch of ants.
Yeah, or I'll play, like, I'm friends with Nathan Fillion, and so I went over to his house and we were playing like Halo or something, and he just destroyed me. Like, he's like a 12-year-old boy, and it wasn't any fun because I kept dying. So I'm like, I'm gonna go home and play this on my own without you, Nathan Fillion.
Nathan f-ing Fillion.
I think you're so Captain Mal.
Oh my lord. I love that. That's too funny, dude.
That is really good. Yeah, I'm also super looking forward to Cyberpunk 2020. Someone in chat asked you a follow-up question. Would you play Phasmophobia? Which I don't know if you've heard anything about that.
Don't know. I've never heard of it.
So it
sure.
It is a multiplayer-centric game, though. But it's a ghost hunting game. So you're hunting different spirits in abandoned and haunted homes and locations, and you can play a single player, can't you? I think you can. It's very freaky. It has VR support. You also walk insanely slowly. That's the thing I don't like about it, but
yeah, I
truly
like it.
Terrifying. I have a question for you. Since you're a fan of cinema, all of that goes with it. What did you think of Ghost of Tsushima? Like how they honored Kurosawa in such a beautiful and like excellent way. Like, were you playing like Kurosawa mode right from the get? Like everything black and white, traditional. This is going in, or were you kind of like, let me enjoy the colors first and then look at like, you know, the this piece of media through Kurosawa's lens, or just like or did you have your own take on it?
I love the Kurosawa mode, but I couldn't see very well. Mm. It's harder to see because scratchy white. And so I kept getting, shot in the head or whatnot, which I hated. So so I mostly played it in color. But I think what they did visually was, it's one of the most beautiful games I've ever seen. It's, you know, and having spent so much time in Japan, and I love samurai films, you know, for a Western company to execute a samurai world like that took so much respect and talent. And, you know, I was utterly blown away by it.
Mm-hmm.
I just loved it. But the Kurosawa mode, I just had trouble picking out my targets.
Yeah. I can totally understand.
No worries. That's
the color version was so beautiful. I mean, you know, but I loved
it. Oh, yeah.
But I love the fact that you could make it Kurosawa. Like, I would change it to Kurosawa mode for cutscenes and stuff like that. And I played it in Japanese.
Mm.
So, you know, it felt very authentic and
nice.
Accurate. That's awesome. Yeah, no. I love it. What's your favorite, if you can remember, if not, no big deal. What's your favorite line of, like, the whole game? Because there's one for me that at least sticks out pretty well.
Oh, I don't recall. What's your favorite line?
Honor died on that beach. Or, well, I don't want to spoil for anyone that hasn't beaten
right.
But it's the delivery and just everything about it, and how he's accepted everything up until that point and just realized what's going on and what's going to happen for his future is just kind of like, ooh, satisfaction.
It's
just,
yeah.
Ooh. Yeah. Yeah. It was very cool. Again, I listened to it in Japanese, so I would have gotten a different delivery, but
yeah.
But yeah, those moments were amazing.
Yeah. Here's a loaded one.
Okay.
If you could direct your own video game, what would it be like?
I've flirted with writing video games and possibly producing video games, but I've discovered it's a very different world. I mean, an entirely different world from movies and TV. You know, you'd think it'd be similar, but it really is not. It's a very specific skill set. I don't really see that being an avenue of my career. You know, if somebody offered it to me and it was a really amazing world and I thought we could execute it in a cool way, I would certainly consider it because I love games so much. But I don't think I could wrap my head around it.
Mm.
You know, I understand setting up shots and I understand directing actors and I understand, you know, production design, things like that. But I just, you know, constructing a game seems like a burden combined with a hassle.
Yeah. You know, that was always one of my dreams growing up is to create video games. And, you know, it still is a dream of mine. It is still something that I would love to do. But now having the experiences that I've had, doing the things I've had, it's kind of helped me understand what that would look like a lot better than it did when I first had the dream, which is like,
yeah.
You don't realize just how much like pacing will matter with regards to writing out what happens next. Because in, you know, a stealth game, for example, a player may take an hour on a segment that would typically only take 15 minutes to like a very skilled player knows what they should do generally, that can completely throw off every line that comes after that.
Yeah.
It's a very specific talent. And
yeah.
And here's the other big secret. Like, I always dreamed of making movies.
Yeah.
And I've been lucky enough to do so a few times, number of times. It's so hard to enjoy your own movie.
Mm.
You know, it's hard for me to watch X-Men or Watchmen or whatever and not see all of the mistakes and remember all of the pain and all of the horror that went into it. And it's like Steven Spielberg, I always say Steven Spielberg is the only person on earth who can't watch Raiders Lost Ark and enjoy it.
You know? Yeah.
Like so you could make a great game, but to you, it wouldn't be a great game.
Yeah,
right.
A giant, painful ordeal.
Yeah. As someone that works, like closer to video games now more than ever, I have very much learned the difference that a lot of different producers, different, you know, technical writers, all that kind of come in and just create this experience and how hard it is to cut certain things out and how much you need certain things. And at first I was like, I'm all for it, let's go. Now I see that and I'm like, oh my God, that is equal parts beautiful and equal parts terrifying. You know,
it's work. I mean, it's you know, you think by making a Metal Gear that you'll be living Metal Gear. It's like, no, you'll be living rendering and budgets and hassles, and it's, you know, so I'd rather just enjoy games because I think my creative strengths lie elsewhere.
Mm-hmm.
That's fair. Love it. Yeah.
why don't we do one more, and then I should probably get back to my family who probably forgotten about me.
that's my last question, actually.
I've run out your interest.
Trust me, I could go longer, but I want to be respectful. Plus, we'll have further conversations about other things anyway. So,
well, people can always, you know, find me on Twitter and ask me questions there, and I try to interact with people you know, that are nice, which most people are. Honestly. And and I got to say, you know, this was such a great conversation, and thank you, gentlemen, for having me and showing such sincere interest and being so sharp and engaging. And I wish you all success and love and happiness for the rest of your days.
Same to you, man.
Tremendously appreciated.
Yeah, we're really excited to have you on the show in general, and hopefully this experience has been the best podcast experience you've ever had.
Probably the best I've ever had. I would say that.
Okay, I'll take that.
I think you can put that on a resume. I think you can just put it in quotes.
David Hayter said this was the best podcast.
Very best. Oh man! All right. Thank you again. We'll be in touch. I'll let you know where it'll be live everywhere and blah blah blah.
Well, that sounds good. And thank you to your fans and everybody who tuned in to listen. I also wish you love and happiness and success and follow your dreams and go into the world and make it better and kick ass.
One potential request. Feel free to say no. Using whatever voice you'd like to use. Could you just say you're now listening to the Black Oni podcast?
This is Solid Snake, and you are now listening to the Black Oni podcast. So pay some damn attention. Damn.
That was.
Bruh.
Wow. That was great.
Okay.
That was great.
Good. Well, thank you so much, gentlemen. And if you need anything else, reach out. And in the meantime, rock on. Be well.
Be well. Make sure y'all go follow him, obviously. Go follow him, David B. Hayter, on Twitter. I'll give you the link right here.
Thank you so much. This was so much fun for us. Seriously. Thank you again.
Good. All right. I'll talk to you soon. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye.
Go ahead. Go ahead, cheese.
Do you think this is you?
You know, I'm just so like, I held my composure as best as I could, and that's all you can ask for me. That's all you can ask.
Hey, yo, chat, can we just get a check Will's pants, please? Because I think the man might need a fresh new pair of pants.
A chubby wubby.
Listen,
I ain't trying to get banned on Twitch or nothing, right?
Switching over to Plexstorm real quick.
Welcome to Black Oni on Plex. I just start stripping it. Everyone's just like, no, please put that back. No mask.
You know, I can't say too much about what the future holds for anything that I do right now. So I'm going to leave it at, you know, this is the beginning of just many more really dope things coming to what it is that I do here on whatever you're listening on, whether it's Twitch or YouTube or iTunes or Spotify, whatever you're using to listen to this. There are many more exciting things happening in the near future. I want to take a moment to thank Dream Manifested as well as Yo It's Yodu for coming on to the show as well. I really, really do appreciate the two of you also joining. We could go.
Yo, can I just say one thing though? This is the culmination of your hard work. This is the culmination of always streaming when people would be like, why are you doing this? Why are you gonna do this? Every day that you thought of just stopping it and just doing something else. Yo. Yo. Yo!
I've definitely struggled with that before in the past, of course, just like any creator, really. Yeah. Thank you, everyone who's here right now. I know there are a lot of other shows that are competing for time just as much. I know there's the Into the Motherlands. They're doing their thing today as well. And a lot of my communities cross over to that as well. So thank you, everyone, for being here in general. This was more. It was definitely a thing that I put on for y'all as well. But like, this was a very much a self satisfying goal for me as well, because again, you all know, I don't even have to explain to you all like how much I appreciate his contributions to my own upbringing as a artist, as an unknowing artist at the time, you know? But yeah, I'm just really proud of you guys as well. You know, y'all had some really great questions. Chat, y'all had great questions as well. We used a new platform to do the video today, so it was a little different, but it was better than probably what Discord would have been, because you know, if we had cut out, for example, it would have just the entire thing would have just been a whole different situation. So what are you guys getting into later today, or throughout the week, or just in general? What y'all got going on? What can people expect to see out of you two?
Well, they won't see this. Just me spamming the crap out of both of you in the in the Discord chat with just some, you know, just shocked memes all the time. Just nothing but shocked Pikachu's going down. But no, man, this is great, man. This is great. This is.
I didn't even occur to me to like do that or be like, it just didn't occur to me because like I was running production.
So focused.
I was focused on making sure that he was enjoying himself, that you all at home were enjoying yourselves.
You did that though. You did.
But
that.
You did it without even, dude. You looked so calm throughout the whole thing. So you're just kind of like, yeah, that's fine, no problem. The back of his head, he's like, why is Chris disconnected? I'm gonna fucking kill him.
You know, I thought about the possibilities of something happening, and I was just like,
and it, but success.
Yes.
This is great. This is the labor. This is the love. The coming through and paying off dividends. So from one person that you've definitely pushed into the position where I'm at right now, the person that, you know, has started me, galvanized me to make podcasts, be part of podcasts, and to chase gaming in a different light, I just want to say you motherfucking did it, kid.
Thank you.
Let them have
yo, Jamil, kill, bro. Jamil. What you want to say?
Let them happy tears flow, bro. It's all right. You know what I'm saying?
It's
a milestone, dog. But it's one of many to come. Already know what it is. You already know the goals. The goals ain't gonna go nowhere because you hit one. Let's keep it moving. The
goals just keep. That's right. Coming.
Yeah, let's keep it moving. But no, for real though, like that was out of all the ones I've been a part of, I feel like that was one of the. For it to have so much behind it for you. That was probably one of the smoothest conversations that we've been able to have with someone of that caliber. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah,
it really was. And the fact that
he was so easy to talk to. He was engaged. He made it very easy.
So easy.
So unbeknownst to him, I don't know what kind of conversation y'all had prior, but unbeknownst to him, how much he had meant to you and his contributions, like. I know that it from me, from my point of view, just as someone who's a fan, it's just a beautiful thing to know that his character, you know, mirrored everything that you were hoping of him. His ability to talk to us, to laugh and joke and all of that, and just be palpable. You know what I'm saying?
I honestly didn't even know that RPGs were his favorite and that Batman was his favorite. That's me. That's me.
That's. I, you know what I felt like we were here for, though, and this is me being very frank. Is like, it's like to see we have front row tickets to see like, you know, like a show, like a late night show that come to life, and we're just like it was amazing, dude. Like I am pretty, I've gotten better at articulating myself, but today I felt like I'm like, so it's been really like super sweet, very down to earth. Made it super easy to talk to us, but also engaged us and actually gave us fulfilling answers to questions, because a lot of the times you get very simple or kind of answers. So this was very, very well done. And kudos to you. Kudos to Theo Yamil over here. Look at him. Look at him being all...
What do you mean?
Look at his smile. Look at
what
that smile.
What do you mean? I'm going to hit shit.
For those of you that can't... Yeah, okay. For those that you can't watch, if you're listening to this on iTunes, Dream Manifested had this grin from side to side. Look at that, with the pearly white side. Look at this little fucker. This has been great.
Yeah. Yeah. This is one of the podcasts with Only Dreams DJ Andy, which was your first podcast. Yeah, that's right. That's right. Your ties for favorite podcast. Hey, listen, I can't promise that every other podcast is going to be as great as this one was. But I'll make my promise to do my best to try to get it to be that, whether it's a special guest, whether it's just, you know, the regulars coming on to just shoot the shit. I'm going to do my best to make sure y'all have a wonderful experience at wherever it is you're listening, because that's important.
You got to love it.
Yeah.
Oh yeah. So the thing is, guys, if you came in for David Hayter, but stayed because of the chemistry between everyone, appreciate it. Thank you. The engagement doesn't stop. They are as humble as they are, and they are very humble.
Yeah. Yeah, man.
It's just great.
Yeah, I'm really, really excited. We got sidetracked. Where can people go to find you, Dream?
You can find me on Twitch at twitch.tv/DreamManifested. The same for Twitter and Instagram as well. SoundCloud, all those kinds of things. Dream Manifested is the way to go. You feel me?
Mm. And what about you, Itioru?
Well, feel free to follow me on my Instagram. I started posting more like cosplay stuff on there again. I'm getting that creative urge back again. I'll be hopefully start streaming when I get back to Boston. So that's gonna be exciting. Gonna set up a new set, but please feel free to follow me at Yo It's Yoru on Twitch and It's Yoru on Instagram. But thank you, Will. Where can people find you, Napkin?
Everything's Black Oni. Even YouTube now. We got Black Oni now.
So we got it.
We got that shit.
Oh, we got it.
Yes. Yes. God, finally.
Damn, that took like eight. That,
yeah, it was like eight.
8 years.
It was a long time. You know, Salvatore Beltris, you might have, you know, I my sinuses are a little congested right now. You know, my eyes are a little, you know, there's onions being cut near me. Thank you all so much. I might be live again later. Mm. Or I might just be working on all the other shit I have to do as well, or working on uploading this to all the other locations that you can expect it. But thank you all so, so, so very much. We're going to bring this love to another broadcaster to help make their night amazing. But if you would all just join me in doing that, that would be wonderful.
Wunderbar.
Ah.